this. And now let me share my screen again. Okay, let me share my screen. Good. And now let me go to my slides. Yes, here it is. That is something nice. So we'll talk about extension of combustion science. I think from the first lecture, I start talking about this, that, you know, at some point, I tell you, anything wrong? Okay, let me see something goes. I should mute somebody. No? Is everyone muted? Okay. Let me see what's happening. I try to understand what's wrong. Because I should not have this for the entire screen, right? Okay, so let's see what we have. No, let's press like this. Okay, let me for a minute stop sharing here. Let me then. Okay. Yeah, now I think we're okay, right? I want just to have to hold mode for the, okay. So extension of combustion science. In fact, at first lecture and even later, I told you that, in fact, you know, combustion science is quite old field as compared to something fascinated that people deal with, like in the field of, in umbrella of nano, bio, info. But mathematical apparatus and knowledge and analogy that we have from combustion, from flame front, from either, we really can very often employ in other research fields. Because you know that even from the very beginning, I told you that combustion science is something like its interplay between physics and chemistry, between fluid dynamics, between heat transfer and chemistry and thermodynamics. All, and then, so you, to be expert in combustion, you should be expert in all these fields. So sorry for this frame that appear. I hope they will go out at some point. Now, so extension, if you talk about extension, what would it actually mean for us? We will employ I'm sorry for this. I hope I should finish. It's my last lecture this semester, so I should be able to finish it, right? It will be pretty easy if I not. I will not, but I will. I want to have full screen resolution at least. Okay, let me go like this, and then I have like this. But by some reason, it does not want me as soon as I click it. I misunderstand why it's like this. Okay, let me try this. Well, I will keep, if you don't mind, I keep talking. When this frame disappears, I will make full screen mode here. Because if I click on it, there will be no way to come back to the screen. So basically, why we talk about extension of combustion science? What does it mean for us? In fact, it means the following. It means that we want to resume slideshow. Oh, okay. Resume slideshow. It means for us that we try to employ all this apparatus, heat transfer equation, idea about discontinuity surface between something to other fields that we can view. So basically, and classical approach that many combustion scientists work with is nothing but it is astrophysics and supernova. So here that, I don't know how to avoid it. Okay, so here it is. So what I'm sorry for this gap. So what we have? Extension of the science. So which really areas we deal with? First of all, astrophysical combustion. And as I told you, classical examples are supernova. When people, because what a supernova explosion, it's actually, I will talk about this a little bit. It's nothing but, in fact, transition from deflagration to detonation, from subsonic to supersonic conversion regime in stars. But the difference is from combustion that here, instead of chemical reaction, like we have in terrestrial combustion, in supernova, we have nuclear reaction, it's thermonuclear reaction. But also other fields like interstellar chemistry, when we have chemical conversion, also all the history of universe after Big Bang, like what happened in the first milliseconds of universe, it's all quark baryon transitions, neutrinos, neutrino physics. They are related like to our ideas about front. A front can propagate, penetrate something and proceed. And basically this really very wide extension of it. There is example of neutrino driven flame, because this is, that is the idea that when it was Big Bang, you know, that neutrino moved through the, from the center of this explosion, and this neutrino move, and they actually eventually all other matter appeared and they move universe. So there is a theory how it may go. There is idea about it was like a front of neutrino, and this front moves. You know, neutrino can easily penetrate any substance. It's like semi-transparent piston for us, and that's how it goes. Now, optical combustion. Why we call it optical combustion? Why optical in quotes? One of them, because it concerns laser ignition and laser ablation, and I've explained. On the one hand, very often we use real laser in combustion studies. For instance, very often when you have spark ignition, use laser to ignite. And you use laser like for measurement of combustion, like for PIV measurement of velocity fields. So that's laser. But on the other hand, there is an application of laser, what we call laser ablation, because that's the way how we deal with internal confined fusion. When we want to have thermonuclear deuterium-tritium reaction, and when you have emit such a target, and that's laser ablation, and it propagates like a front. Now there are also called Fischer fronts. Fischer fronts, it's something like biological or chemobiological fronts in the body. Like for instance, if you have some swelling which propagates, or you have some conversion from life or non-life cells in the body, any front which propagates, any organic or semi-organic front which propagates with small thermal expansion, that is Fischer front. Again, it's extension of combustion. And eventually, we also had advanced materials, and today we'll talk about two topics here, about magnetic avalanche in crystals of nanomagnets and about organic semiconductors. You will see there are phenomena there that really, really very, very resembling combustion. Supernova. In fact, you may know, well, again, when astrophysics is very fascinating area, and sometimes when I try to dive in it, I say that, you know, why engineers and physicists write textbooks, astrophysicists write detective stories. It's really something amazing how people can make conclusions with very little knowledge about what happened in space. Like, you know, if you talk about combustion, turbulent combustion, for instance, you measure expanding flames, you have laser diagnostics, you have simulations, you have a lot of knowledge about physics, and still we don't know how to describe turbulence, how to describe turbulent combustion. When you see space, when you see astrophysics, what do you know about that star? The only thing you know, you can measure its mass because how it interacts with other bodies, and you can somehow measure its light. And based on this, maybe you can estimate distance to it. And based on this parameter, you can develop the entire theory. That's amazing. And there are two types of supernovas that people talk about, thermonuclear and gravitation. So what are they? So typically, what thermonuclear, what happens, what happens if you have classical star? How stars burn? Basically, what we have in a star, we have gravity. And if you remember when we talk about expanding flames, I show you some particular problem about what flame do in gravitational field. Here you have star. So you have, what a star? It's very, very massive body. Very, very heavy body. And basically, gravity is balanced by pressure there. So pressure generator has high temperature and you have thermonuclear reaction. And basically what reactions go, you may know that like most of our universe is just plasma. And most of our elements in universe are hydrogen. Like 90% of universe is hydrogen. And about 9% is helium and less of them are other elements. So if you take a look at periodic system in the Mendeleev table, if you look at periodic system, that's how it goes. And each helium generates, so hydrogen generates helium, maybe by through the stage of deuterium and tritium, heavy and super heavy hydrogen. Helium generates lithium and so on until we come to steady carbon on oxygen. I talk about just nuclear, of course, right? No electrons. And you may know, and if you proceed in this way, it's a so-called, that is what we call fusion. After, and we call, so we have so-called iron peak, ferron peak, right? So you may remember that for element, for light elements here, when they get combined, for them fusion is beneficial. So it generates energy release. They combine, they're not decaying. But when you come to level, to ferrum, to iron, after this heavy elements, it is beneficial for them to decay to produce energy. That's why when people like use nuclear reactors, nuclear power plant, what happens there? They have like uranium, plutonium, which decay because it's a heavy element. But for small elements, it is fusion that goes. And basically that is a reaction that people use in H-bomb or try to use in controlled fusion. So that's how it is. So basically, what is that star that we call white dwarf? So it will happen with our sun, with any kind of star, that eventually everything is burned there. So imagine that the reaction ends up. There is no hydrogen there anymore. So what happens? Then it like becomes like a dead star. It's like heavy body with no reaction. Sometimes actually you may consider like very often it happens that you have like a double star. So you have this white dwarf and there is another white dwarf that they interact. And this, so this is very like heavy body. By mass, it's about like solar mass. By size, it's about like planet, like satellite, like moon, for instance. So its diameter is about like say from 100 to 1000 kilometers. And this called dead star stay for very long time. And it has mass accretion because you have dust in universe. So dust come to it, so its mass grows. And eventually when this mass grows higher than so-called Chandrasekhar limit, at the center, explosion happens. And that reaction starts, that's how it goes. And how does explosion may happen? Again, is it subsonic or is it supersonic? And well, there is no final answer, but people say like this. If it was subsonic reaction, like a flame, then what would happen? Then, in fact, it would propagate and basically you would absorb it. But what people understand that if you have a flame, that matter around it is not prepared, but in our case, it's prepared. But what people realize at the what we see is that there is like an envelope which is pushed in radial direction. That may happen only if this is a detonation. And to explain this, there is only idea that it's a flame which is converted into detonation. And I think you show this, I saw you this movie before, how it happens. This is a computational movie, but it explains how bubbles appear, how flame propagates in stars. That is actually how flame propagate in space, in gravitational field. And again, you may say, why do you look at flame? It's not terrestrial flame. Yes, it's not terrestrial flame. Because, but all ideas, all approaches you use here, it's really adoptable. The only thing, instead of chemical reaction, you have thermonuclear reaction here. It's like supernova reaction. And many people from combustion science, like Elaine Oran, like Kim Woosley, they wrote a really good textbook on astrophysics. I always wanted to go to astrophysics, but didn't have real chance yet, frankly speaking. So basically, and what you may see here, this is classical simulations. They were published in journal Nature. And this is like brain-like flame. So what happens, this is actually, you see, it looks like brain, right? In fact, it's expanding flame in supernova explosion. This classical thermonuclear explosion, so that it is. You have these turbulent flames which are ignited and expands. small scale. That's really amazing results. It's yeah, they published many years ago actually, but when they appeared, it was really something amazing. So key point, if you want to do astrophysics, you may be combustion scientist, right? You can really expand it here because everything we know about combustion, about turbulence, it's here. What I learned in my turbulent and combustion class is enough to get this result. Just a little bit knowledge about nucleus things. Now, that was classical supernova, thermonuclear supernova, but there are other gravitational supernova. When they happen for very, very, very massive stars. And that is actually how black hole may be formed eventually. It happens for this really massive stars. So what I talked before, it was stars which are with near Chandrasekhar mass. So it's about 1.4 and more up to 2 solar masses. This is very massive star, like from 8 to 40 solar masses. Solar means our sun, our star. So why we talk about it, this one? Because this is very, very, very massive star. So it's so massive that at the center you have extremely big density, like 10 to the 14 gram per centimeter. And basically what will happen here that if you have how star look like, we have all the elements, you start with hydrogen, but if it's so massive, you have helium, lithium, and eventually you have iron in the center. You don't have more than iron because that corresponds to the peak. Other elements cannot appear. So what happens, how this explosion happens? Let me explain you. In fact, mass increases and increases and increases. At some point in the center, you have something that people call neutron star. What is neutron star? And what do you know about neutron? Neutrons don't exist in free space. They exist only when they're connected. Like for instance, if you have any kind of element, how any nuclear consists of? It consists of protons and neutrons together. But neutron itself does not sustain, it lives for about 15 minutes and then it collapses into proton and electron, correct? So, what do you know about neutrons? What is the spin of neutron? It's one. You know that neutrons, they actually obey statistics, they are bosons. They obey statistics of Bose-Einstein, right? And what do we know about these statistics? We know that in any quantum state, you may have as many of them as possible. Now, what do we know about fermions? Electrons and protons, they are fermions. They obey Pauli principle. And what is Pauli principle? Pauli principle says that in one quantum state, you don't have more than one elementary particle. And that's how your star is formed. So imagine you cannot have all protons and all electrons together. You cannot have all of them because they are separated. They are fermions. Okay? Now, imagine that at some point when you have this heavy star, your protons and electrons are under such a big pressure that they are collapsing into neutrons. What does it mean? That neutron star is forming. It will mean that in the center, I become neutron. And neutrons, they are bosons, they can be in the same state. So imagine you have something similar. Imagine you have apple, very nice apple. But there is some worm sit in this apple and eat it in the center. What will happen? All apple can collapse inside, right? The same story here. So imagine that in the center of this heavy, heavy star, very, very, very extremely massive star, at the center of the star, I have, you know what? I have reactions that protons and electrons start making neutrons, start making neutron star. And then all these layers around, you will see here, all these layers around. So one layer, another layer, they will disappear. They will collapse into the center because now there is no distance between fermions because they're bosons. So all these layers can collapse down. So I will have nothing here. I will have here just my star. And then what happened? Imagine I have empty space now here. Then outer layers will collapse down as well. And so on. So in fact, what happened is like neutrino-driven flame, which expands. And this neutrino-driven flame consumes all the layers which go down. This really resembles what happened at Big Bang, at the very beginning of universe. And now, that depends on the mass. If your mass is from 8 to 40 solar masses, then it is neutron star which is formed. How they call it, quasar, as far as I know. But if you mass exceed 40 solar masses, it will be black hole which will be formed like this. Does it make sense? I'm not expert in astrophysics, it's just basic introduction, but that's how people simulate. And here you may see bubble and gravitational supernova, and you may see, it's not Bychkov, it's Bykov, it's another person who did it, but you may see that how it looks like, how it goes. And here really there is no infinity sign, so that is how gravitational supernova goes. You may see how it is formed here and how it expands and what is forming here. Still some kind of infinity sign happens, let's see. So it, and what does it mean that it's infinity sign happens? Exactly like it was last problem, your homework number 5. It will mean that, what? It will mean that relator instability dominate over all last other instabilities. That's how it goes. Look here. Is it nice? Okay, let's proceed. So I just recall. So here I want to, this is thermonuclear explosion. So here how it goes in a creation of the system. So this is thermonuclear, please recall. And the next one will be a gravitation. These are two supernova things. Yeah, please, I will take a little bit of more your time after 5 o'clock. I want to finish this lecture, but I do want to finish this topic today because it's last lecture. Not much, but we still have about 10 minutes until 5, and then maybe a little bit more. And anyway, everything will be recorded and posted. So this is bubble, this is like brain, like that's how it goes. You see this turbulent structures, brain-like structures, and this is gravitational supernova, how it formed. Here it is. Here it is. And here, this is this shape of the body is formed. Infinity-like sign is formed. Okay. In addition to supernova, what else did we talk about? This is laser ablation. This is inertial confined fusion. So you know, for a long time, there is a question how to use controlled fusion. And you know what the problem about controlled fusion? That controlled fusion happens at extremely high atmospheres. So basically, the unlike nuclear reaction, which releases radiation, here it would be quite safe because what do we have here? You have deuterium and tritium, which form neutrons and helium. And that actually would happen in stars. So actually, you know that what is our sun is nothing but very big H-bomb. But it works not like H-bomb, it works like control reactor. Why? Because we can control it. We can confine it because it's internal gravity. But if you want to do terrestrial engine like this, a terrestrial reactor, you cannot confine it because temperatures you deal there are thousand million of degrees. So definitely no matter can handle it. What people, how people try to handle it, people, and you need some time to hold it while the reaction goes. No like walls, no chamber can use for this. What people try to do, people do so typically the so-called magnetic traps, different kind of magnetic, electromagnetic fields, which plays a role of all. It didn't work out yet, but that's what people try. There are tokamaks, if you know, then people use with plasma and how to control. But there is another way what people can do. It's so-called laser ablation and laser ignition. So what people do, imagine that you have like deuterium and tritium mixture, spherical geometry here. What actually happens that if you, what you can do, if you have set of lasers, you can ablate it by lasers. So lasers will eliminate it. illuminate. A laser will illuminate it from different sides, as I showed here. A laser will push it. It will be like plasma pressure on it, and the reaction will go. And basically, what we'll have here is like a front, like a flame front. It will be laser ablation, which will propagate like a front towards us. Here you may see how it goes. It's like targeting through laser radiation, and here you will have acceleration field, and here your laser ablation front. It's a front of transformation of reaction of plasma. So what is good and bad here? Good is good idea. And basically, I should tell you one person who used to deal with combustion. It's the guy named Betty. He is, or at least he has been, a director of PPPL, Princeton Plasma Physics Laboratory, and he employed combustion studies to this one, to laser ablation. So that is the way how you can hold it. This is alternative to tokamaks and tokamakos all of the system. But the key point here is that it's very grave, very unstable system. You have relative instability and you have the Randall instability here. So basically that's how your reaction goes. This is your reaction front. You have target, so that's what you have. You will have classical size of laser ablation. This will be your deflagration-like front, which will propagate. And if it was stable, if it was planar solution, people would solve it. But the key point is that it's not very easy to solve. Again, what you may see here, don't you think it's very resemble classical front? So what you have here, you have like ablation thickness, which is like active reaction zone. And you have this value L, which is size of your target, and which is about two orders of magnitude larger than this one, right? So what is resembles this? This really resembles the real Landau cutoff wavelengths, right? Because that is nothing but effective thickness of your ablation wave. It's quite small, it's all the sizes, like if this is micrometer, it's a small, it propagates. But the key point, and that's how it goes. And here you can see the quite an analogy to real flame. So let's see, this is your flame. This is your fuel mixture, this is your burst mixture, this is your flame thickness, how it happens in reality. And this is your laser ablation. Here you have a laser radiation flow, here you have flame thickness, here you have active reaction thickness, here you have your flow. From dense plasma, it goes to light plasma, how it goes. But the key point, what will be our rates here? And people investigated many times, there are ways how to describe it by means of gravity, by means of the Randall instability, and people discuss how it goes. But the key point is this system is quite unstable. And I will explain it. So look at the slide, please. If you talk about comparison with real flames, so for typical flames, what is thermal expansion for typical flame? It's from 5 to 8, from 5 to 10, right? And remember what happens because of theta. Theta generates combustion instability. Theta generates new volume. That's why flame accelerates. For ablation, the theta is extremely big. It may be, yes, it starts from 5, but it may be up to 100. It's a really big number. So you may realize that your instability with laser ablation is much, much stronger. It's absolutely unstable, very unstable. So that is the point. In combustion science, people sometimes say instability is not important. I told you it's important. Why it's important? Because it's come to resonance, to turbulence, and other features. But in laser ablation, if you employ combustion science, it's really hot and crucial topic. In combustion science, combustion instability is just more mathematical nice problem. In laser ablation, it's crucial problem how to control thermonuclear reaction. It's very important. Other comparison between flame and ablation. Compressibility. What do we know about flame? You know that detonation is supersonic, flame is very subsonic, right? So our typical Mach numbers for flame is really like 1/100, right? 10^-2, because really flame propagates with centimeters, meters per second, it's 10^-2 of sound speed. For laser ablation, this value is quite big. It's subsonic, but it's about 77% of Mach number is about 77%. It's quite big. It's quite big, and it also shows that compressibility is serious where you put shock waves, compression waves, they go there. Even subsonic, it shows all those features that we don't face for normal flame. And last, but not least, which is important, how your transfer properties depends on thermal conduction, it depends on temperature. How transfer properties like thermal conduction depend on temperature. For compassion, especially for compassion theory, quite often we may neglect such a temperature dependence. Why? Because typically, if you take this heat conduction, typically people say it's like a constant or root square of T. Well, to be very rigorous, typically people employ in quotes what we call Sutherland formula. But generally speaking, root square of temperature is not a bad approximation. What does it mean? So in fact, if my temperature increases 5 times, root square of temperature give me increase 2 times. So, well, not big. And generally speaking, nu is from 0 to 5 of flames. But for ablation, it's really big number. It's from 2 to 6. And you know the temperature, so it's temperature to this number, and this is your expansion. So imagine you have expansion 100 times, and this 100 will be to power 6. It's billion times. So your transport properties change billion times during the reaction. Imagine how strong effect is it. So all these nonlinear equations that we solve for flames, which people say that, okay, it's nice mathematical problem, but far from reality, here it's really crucial. But it's full analogies, and that's why people from combustion science go to do this. And you're welcome to do it. So this is difference from flames to detonation. Last two couple of points. So that's real example. But now there are other examples. Now I will not talk about energy release. I will talk about something else. I will talk about semiconductors, about material science. And that is last topic today. Two chapters here. Give me about 10 minutes to finish it. So what do you know about semiconductors? I think you know something about semiconductors, right? And I think you know. And basically, organic semiconductors, what are semiconductors? What it is? So you know that there are dielectrics, there are conductors, and semiconductors are something in between them. So if you put them into a field, you have transition from electrical to dielectrical, dielectric from electrical state. That is known. But these three guys, they got Nobel Prize in 20 years ago in discovering so-called organic semiconductors. What they realize? They realize the following, that there are materials that behaves as follows. In typical semiconductor, when you put them into a field, they switch right away, immediately switch from one state to another. But here, it switches not right away, but slowly. So basically, what will happen when you put them into the field? It will be something like front of ions and front of electrons. They will move together, and where they meet, it will be so-called p-n junction, and you will have transition to conducting state. Let's see how it goes. Here you may see the movie. And this movie really, it's a new scientific approach how we describe it. So we see fronts of electrons, fronts of ions, they go together, and when they meet, it will be p-n junction, it will be light emitting feature. Okay. Question. Now you say, how people, where we could use this? Where could this light, and then you see it propagates. So where we can see this light emitting cells? Idea is like this. First, I will tell you stupid idea, but then I will tell you something sophisticated. So you know that when you talk about other sources of energy, so imagine that very often, actually, my son very likes, and in summertime, we see the so-called insects, like light insects, which we call light worm, right? You know, they are flying and they emit light. And in evening time, when it's not very dark, you may see them like small lamps. So in fact, if you care about electricity, ideally you should think like this. Okay, instead of having an electrical lamp or candles, why don't we have a tank with light worms? You will feed them and they will produce light for you. Imagine such a situation. It will really clean energy. It will be very organic. Well, that's a stupid idea. If you just feed these worms to make light. But what is not so stupid, if you don't feed real worms, but you can use light emitting cells that they have on their bell, which produces light. And that is here. Because that is what people used for optoelectronics, for light emitting cells, for photodiodes, that's how it is. For instance, how device like cell phones work when you have touch pads, when you interact. In principle, you have device, then you touch it and you want to switch. That is like trigger, right? So imagine you want to turn off and turn off some device. So here you will see these fronts go together, front of electrons and front of ions. They will go and they will come together and eventually you have the junction. And how long do you think it takes to go from this state to unit? It takes about a minute for small device. Why it takes about a minute? Simple, because you know we have electrons and holes. And holes like are like protons. Because electrons are, you know, it depends on mobility. Electrons are very light, but you know that ions are heavy. One ion weight like 2,000, like 1,800, something like this, like 2,000 electrons. So mobility of ions is small. And because mobility of ions is quite small, one of these front go very slowly. It goes very slowly. That's why if you want your device to work faster, you should somehow accelerate these fronts. How to accelerate? An idea comes from the following idea. These fronts resemble combustion fronts. And it was possible to describe it. It's not a joke. It was possible to describe this front propagation based on plasma theory that really behaves like combustion. But what do we know about combustion? How do we accelerate combustion? What do we do to accelerate combustion? One of the ways to accelerate combustion, make your front unstable. And you see, in this front, we also found so-called plasma instability. Because it's really, this instability resembles the real Landau instability. It's analog, but it resembles. So how the real Landau instability works? You have pressure abundance from one side, which forbids the flame, it develops. Here you will have abundance of electrical field, high electric field here, low here, and that it accelerates. And picture here, you will see that picture on the bottom, it's numerical simulation of the real Landau instability, okay? But these two tops, when you have these fingers, it's real experiments. Here are real experiments of these fronts, front of electrons and front of holes, how they go together. So these are electrons, these are holes, and then you may see how they go towards. And when they meet, p-n junction start. And picture on the bottom also show this is our theoretical prediction, and this stuff, this front, these colors show electrical field positive or negative. So yellow color corresponds to positive, blue to negative electric field. And you may see really how it goes. So that's how they go. You may see how it changes with time. 3 seconds, 22 seconds, 44 seconds, 73, 92, and then junction happens. And you may realize that what we have here, this line, this yellow line shows really PN junction when it happens. And before it, so these fingers disappear, and that's how junction happens. And you may see that electrons go really fast, these are fingers, but ions almost don't. That it is. And also, what was realized, and you can accelerate. And if you look at the picture here, you may see how fronts go. So here you have P front, it's holes, and here you have N fronts, which is electrons. So they go together, and basically, originally, this blue line, how planar fronts go. So when I plot this, when they go together, remember when these fronts go, when this is one-dimensional front. When they go together, it's really how these two lines show. This is front of, this is doping, two doping fronts, this is front of holes, front of ions, front of electrons, and basically they meet here. So when they will meet, if this time is in seconds, so they will meet about 110 seconds. But when instability happens, that is markers show what you will actually have. And you will see that these fronts will meet at about 100 seconds. So you already have about 10% reduction into time you need to turn off your light emitting cell because of this instability. Now we come to the idea like this. Okay, maybe we can ignite this instability. And this picture shows here that if you compare this and this, what's the difference here and here? Here you ignite instability because you may use cathode or anode, which is corrugated. Then you already intrinsically generate instability, and that's how it will go. And you will see this diagram. What happened when you have intrinsically corrugated cathode or anode? It goes like this, and they will meet here. And in that case, junction happens at 80 seconds instead of 110. So it's really promoted. Does it make sense? So that is application to organic semiconductors. I didn't work on the topic for many years now, for about 10 years, but I think it was, no, 10, actually 8 years. But we published this paper in Good Journal, and basically it's really nice application how you can apply combustion science to something really different from combustion. And one more topic about combustion, it's nanomagnets. So again, I think you all know what are magnetic field and magnets. You know that there are ferromagnetic, paramagnetic, diamagnetic. And what is the idea? And what is molecular magnets? Molecular magnets in crystals, when you have like big crystal, like you have big molecule, and these molecules have like a dipole or like local magnetic field. So I believe you know that if you have, let's say you have magnets which are in magnetic field, and let's say this is H, my external magnetic field. What will happen if I change field direction of field like this externally? What will happen? I think you know that they will do like this, right? That's classical, this momentum in turn, this classical property of paramagnetic field. But people clarify that there are special material, which we call Magnum 20, it's acetate, magnetic acetate, people call it. And in this field, in this magnetic acetate, people face something that people call magnetic avalanche. So instead of switch like this, like we did, here you have avalanche. So when you change the field of H here, when we change the field, magnetic field here, it will happen that it will be front of dipoles, how they will change. It will be like this. And this is really like a front, isn't it? It's magnetic front. Let me show you again. That's how it goes. And so, yes, it resembles front. But if you see it's more similar to combustion than you think before. Why? Because you know why it's changing. Because actually, all this happens at very low temperature, very, very low temperature. At sample size, it's about millimeter. The temperature is here about, it's really cryogenic temperature, near absolute zero. This temperature from 0.2 to 10 Kelvin. And magnetic fields are not small, up to 5 Tesla. So basically, what does it mean here? When I change magnetic field, what happens when I have change in dipole? When they release, small magnetic energy is released. When the small magnetic energy is released, it's enough to increase your temperature, say from 1 Kelvin to 10 Kelvin. And that's how you promote the reaction. Because this magnetic switch, it's really temperature dependent. And in that sense, what happens here? We talk about magnetic deflagration and magnetic detonation. You will say, what kind of detonation? Okay. Remember what is remember back to combustion. What is major difference between the detonation and deflagration? Subsonic and supersonic, correct? What is sound speed? Yes, you know that sound speed is how information propagates in media. So what is sound speed in this system? Remember that sound speed is root square of temperature. Your temperature here is cryogenic, so your sound speed is extremely small. So you can switch from deflagration to detonation promptly, and then you have magnetic DDT and magnetic instabilities. How to employ it? Well, there are many applications, but key of them is quantum computing, and when you write and read data on the hard drives, because remember, if you consider any big hard drive, typically it's magnetic device, how something records it. And when you want to record information faster or read it faster, definitely this avalanche is a way how you can describe it. So that's another application of combustion. So what we talk about today? Astrophysics, supernova, laser ablation, semiconductors, nanomagnets, everything is combustion related. Was it interesting? Let me stop at this point. I think, and I will stop recording. Any question you have now about this lecture? Please let me know. Everybody understood everything? Okay, so any question at all? Okay, I will record this lecture as well after this meeting, so please, I will make two lectures from today. I will post all of them. And as I told you, I will record a couple of more lectures. I hope to do it. So it will be at least lecture 4, lecture 6. I hope to do it at least. So if you want, I can have a help session on Monday If you want, let it be Monday, 10 o'clock, for instance. I can do it. If you want in Zoom, I can send you link about the session that we may have for combustion and maybe for turbulence class together, because it address question and answers if you want. Anyway, you should not worry about your exam much. Please, if you did not finish anything, send me all your homework. I think you did most of your homework. If you owe me any homework, send it to me, please. Otherwise, it's okay. Send me, please, paper review, two paper reviews. And it will be great if you can do it before the final exam. Again, please evaluate this course through student evaluation if you do not make it yet, because I still need... a question is, Christian asked if it can be 11:30 help session. Okay, I will be available I may have another meeting at 12, but 11:30 I will be here. So it's okay, you let it be from 11 to 12, you can join us 11:30 and ask questions. And otherwise we keep talking if you want. Yeah, let it be 11, I will start at 11, okay? So, because 11:30 to 12, too short time, from 11 to 12, you may ask something. If you need more time, we can arrange it again. Okay, that it is. Now, so for your exam, I recall, combustion, you have your topical overview. So please go through it. Please make sure you have something to answer to all the questions. At each topic. Your exam can be similar to midterm exam, but there will be definitely more tasks. Go through all your, I will grade everything I did not grade yet, but since I cannot send back graded on the paper, typically what I do, I give you my graded assignment back and you follow them. But here you follow the solutions, because I will not be able just grade and mark on your assignments. So you have solutions to your midterm. You have solution to all your quizzes. You have solution to all six homework. Actually five homeworks plus last homework is like a quiz. You have all of them. Please follow, please make sure that you know how to solve all these problems, how to answer all these questions. If you do it, you should be okay with your exam. Go through all the slides. Go through all my videos. You can repeat it any times because I posted. What else? That it is. Your exam will be on Wednesday from 8 o'clock and until midnight. And it will be good if by the time I have all your assignments, such that after this I can just post your scores, and then also that I will spend with my turbulence class. Please make student evaluation of this course if you did not make it yet. I know this semester was not the best semester with online teaching, but we should follow it. And still, if I go for full promotion for full professor next year, I still need to have all classes evaluated. Anyway, how to log into the final exam? Okay, I will send you exam by mail. So what will be for exam? I will post it on eCampus. At 8 o'clock in the morning, it will be posted on the major when you have exam folder, and I will send it to you. I will send you for your Word file to you, maybe Word and PDF, in which you will work. So, and what you will do next, since it's open notes, so no big secrets about this, but you have several options. One option, you can type in Word file like you do in homework 6 and send it back to me like a Word file. Or you can print it out and write by hands and scan and send it back to me. Or finally, if you want, you can just, if you don't want to use file that I sent to you, you can just write on a paper and from scratch and send me that paper. Or you can type a separate file and send it to me. I hope there should be no problem with this. Email me, call me if you have questions, concerns, time conflicts. I think we will be able to fix it. Okay, any more question? Okay, then I will thank you again for attending combustion class. I really appreciate you took it. It's really great. So yeah, for help session, I will send a separate email. Let's have it from 11 that we can discuss something. Okay, and anything else? Let's be in touch and thank you for having this class. Okay, now I wish you exam is not so formal interaction, so I wish you good summer time. And I do, and I, what I really wish you that in fall semester we meet like on site, not online, but on site in the university, and we are eligible to go and talk and touch each other. I hope that's what people dream now. Right? And I hope you all will be alive and healthy that time. Okay, thank you and good luck. Yep. Thank you and good luck.